Okay, so I've been using GNU Slash Linux for about 10 years, so I was a teenager. When I was like 15, when I started using GNU Slash Linux, I did like a little kind of work experience thing the school organized for me at this company. I think they ended up being called Marconi, which is like a big telecommunications company. And it was pretty much like straight out of the pages of Dilbert. So I decided that I didn't want to work in the computer industry. And so I studied art and linguistics and went into doing a degree in graphic information design at an art school. Rather than doing the kind of, you know, more kind of normal thing of doing like maths and physics type stuff and doing computer science at university. So that's my kind of personal background. Last year I was in a very nasty car accident and I nearly died. And that made me kind of evaluate, you know, what I was doing with the next 10 years of my life. And so I thought that I can make a real contribution to the free software movement in terms of freeing up typographic culture. There's a kind of funny thing Richard Stallman says, in the early days of the GNU project, where he said he was going to create the GNU system if it was the last thing he did, dying of old age, of course. So I thought that was pretty funny, and I enrolled in the master's degree in typeface design at the Department of Typography at the University of Reading, which is a normally 1 year full-time course, pretty intensive, pretty expensive, and it's a very professional level course which teaches graphic designers how to become professional typeface designers. So with free software, we have a huge amount of high quality programs over the last 25 years that have been built up. And maybe in terms of the practical convenience features, we don't quite have the same level of features and convenience as proprietary alternatives from Apple, maybe we're kind of catching up with Windows. But what's interesting to me is that we don't really have that many fonts which are free software. And we have even fewer typeface designs. And so this is a kind of subtle distinction, the distinction between a typeface and a font. So what is a font? Well, a font is a typeface implemented in software. So you can have the same typeface in wood, and in metal, and in like potato, and when you print it, it will look the same. And when you print out, you know, something with a laser printer out of the computer with a certain typeface implemented in software, it will look the same as the other printing technologies. So there's this kind of reduction question, what is software? Well, software is a combination of programs and data. And programs are functional, it's like a recipe, computer, do this, do that. And because it does a job for you, if it doesn't do the job that you want, then you ought to be free to change it and do what you want. And I'm sure everyone's very familiar with this. Data can be functional as well. And so the classic example is Wikipedia. With an encyclopedia, you use that to do a job, to be informed about something you don't really know about. And if there's an error, like there's a small mistake, like say the page on Bristol might say there's 5 million people here, that would just be a simple error. Or it might just be an error of omission, like there might be pages missing. And the size of the Wikipedia today shows that probably there's a lot of things missing from proprietary encyclopedias. So data can also be like a testimonial, something like a political manifesto or just like a blog post stating your own opinion, something which the purpose of it is to say this party thinks these things. And then data can also be artistic, like a piece of music or a piece of artwork. So fonts are both programs and data in the same file. And that's kind of an unusual thing. Often, you know, things are separated. There's also this idea of source code with programs that's usually very clear. Although maybe you've seen the eToys Squeak applications on the OLPC from the OLPC project, where they have these kind of images with data and programs mixed in. And this caused some problems for distributions like Debian, which were very strict about the licensing and having source code and so on. So an example of the programs that you get in a font, a production font file, are TrueType hints or OpenType features. So TrueType hints are very small little programs in a kind of assembly language where you have the kind of vector curve of a letter shape, and that's kind of projected onto the pixel grid of the screen. And it might not actually meet the pixel grid in the best way. It might overlap two pixels, or it might cause no pixels to be lit up. And so a hinting program that kind of adjusts the curves so that it creates a good fit to the pixel grid. And it's very similar to assembly programming. You know, you take these points and you push them this way, and you know, there's and so on and so on. So Apple actually has that fairly painted. Maybe some of you are aware of the situation with FreeType, which is the piece of free software for drawing text on screen, where they have an auto hinter so that those kind of instructions are figured out on the fly, which is pretty clever. And then OpenType features are things where you can do kind of contextual substitution. So you can say, if you have three O's next to each other, then you can make some of the O's alternate shapes to give the type a little bit of variance, you know, visually. And again, that's very programmatic. Font data really comes down to the shapes, the outline, you know, the nodes or points of the outlines, and the spacing between the letters. And that's just, you know, very simple Cartesian points in a grid and a table of, you know, characters and spacing numbers, integers. So that's kind of the basis of a font. You know, you have something which is very much data and something which is very much programmatic. And the data is really the kind of pure typeface design. And the programmatic stuff is really about that implementation of software aspect. So are typeface designs functional? And that's a tricky question. You know, I've asked Richard Stallman about this, and he says that perhaps display type, which you couldn't really use to set a long paragraph with, could be seen as artistic because it's appreciated visually. It's not really used to do a job with. I would say that all type, when implemented as software, is functional because there might be bugs in the implementation that people want to fix. And just again, that simple Wikipedia example, if there are characters missing from a font, then you might want to add them. That seems like a very functional requirement, even if it's kind of a very display, almost illegible kind of design. So how is type implemented as software with a font editor program? And so I'm just going to run through some of the history of font editors. So I think that reveals some interesting approaches. So one of the earliest digital typesetting systems was Free Software. Of course, it was the Tech system that Don Knuth wrote back in, I think, the late 70s originally. And as part of that original system that he wrote himself, he wrote a font programming language called Metafont. And around the same time in Germany, there was some work, I think it was in URW, where they developed a digital typesetting system with a very different approach, and that's called Icarus. And that had the idea of it was just drawing the outlines of the fonts, whereas the Metafont idea was to describe the kind of internal brush structure of a letter shape. So you might have, for an S here, you could have the kind of internal points and then run a brush over the top of them to create the final form, which is the Metafont approach. And then the Icarus approach was to draw points all around the outside of the letter. And there are benefits and drawbacks to both. And those were really, those are the two approaches which you can take to doing digital typography, digital type design. The GNU project actually had a small font utilities project called Font Utils by Carl Barry, who's a long-time GNU contributor. And that took a similar approach to Metafont in terms of the process, where you had a bunch of small kind of Unix-style utilities that you piped together. And it was using the PostScript technology, which had become dominant by the late 80s, for printing. The opposite approach was this kind of Icarus style with Fontographer, which was a proprietary program originally for Mac, and again, that was building on top of the whole kind of PostScript stack, which was emerging at the time. And Photographer became the real dominant tool that most people designing type and producing fonts used for a long time. And as time went on, the developer stopped really focusing on it. Jim Bonner, the developer, extended the drawing capabilities of the font program written into a general purpose drawing application that was called Freehand. And he sold his company in the late 90s to Macromedia for a lot of money. And in that period, there were some Dutch type designers. And they were good friends with Jim. They'd been beta testing Fontographer for a long time. And they did a kind of deal with him where they got the source code for Fontographer version 3, which is a kind of golden age classic font editor. And they put a Python interpreter on top of it. And this was quite a long time ago, I think 1996, 1997. And they called it RoboFog, so that you could start to script the font editing program, which in that Fontographer vein hadn't really happened before. I mean, obviously with Metaform, that's very programmatic, everything's scripted, but an interactive font editor hadn't been scripted before. So that was quite an important development. There was another program at that time called Font Chameleon, which was also proprietary, and I hadn't actually been able to track down a copy of that, but it's very interesting because it seems to take a Metaform-style approach, where you end up with a bunch of kind of variables attached to sliders, and you can say, well, I want to raise the middle height of these letters, the X height, or I want to raise the full height, or I want to make the font wider, and that kind of thing. And that's the potential of the Metaform approach. And Font Chameleon really kind of pushed the boundaries with that, and it was bought by Adobe and never seen again. CorelDRAW was a proprietary general purpose drawing application which started to integrate type design features, which is, I think, is interesting. And the Adobe Font Developers Kit for OpenType, again, was in this kind of pipeline approach. So with Fontographer, the developer stopped developing it, or slowed down a lot. And then when he sold the company to Macromedia, development stopped completely. And there basically wasn't a high quality font editor being actively developed anywhere. And so there was a retired C++ compiler engineer in Santa Barbara called George Williams, who decided he would start making a font editor because there wasn't any decent one around. And that was originally called PFA Edit. And George has been working on that for about 10 years now. And it's quite impressive, it's free software. And it's now called FontForge. The proprietary alternative in this situation, you know, that came to fill this kind of gap in the market, was FontLab. And FontLab also got a Python interpreter integrated, and the Dutch guys who were working on RoboFog back in the day have been working on a bunch of Python scripts for FontLab's Python interpreter, which they call RoboFan, which is a very very smartly designed object model for dealing with fonts in Python. And so on top of that, they have built various kinds of toolkits for making kind of mini font applications, which I think is interesting. And coming up to the kind of much more recent history, a free software hacker called Rafe Levine, who lives in Berkeley, who was quite active with early GTK development. He did LibArt and tons and tons of stuff. He has developed a new kind of spline technology called Spyro, which is a interpolating spline, which guarantees smooth curves. So that's very interesting, and it's GPL at the moment, GPL only. So that's quite a win for the free software movement in graphics at the moment. So as I say, PFA Edit became FontForge, and that's now, after 10 years of development, a fairly full-featured font editor. Inkscape is an SVG editor, originally started by Rafe Levine, in fact. Rafe Levine did something called Gil, which became Sody Pody, which has become Inkscape. And Inkscape's kind of mandate is to be the SVG font editor. And part of the SVG specification is something called SVG font. And this means that Inkscape is essentially going to become that kind of CorelDRAW style integrated font editor, where you have a general purpose graphic with some text in it, and you say, I don't quite like the look of that font, I want to edit that font. And you kind of click it, kind of zoom down into the font, and start editing it right there on the canvas. And this summer, there's actually a Google Summer of Code student trying to work on that. He's met some dependencies with the text kind of text rendering subsystems, but I think that's very exciting. So the general approaches that I want to kind of draw out of this kind of mini history of font editors, you have this CorelDRAW approach that Inkscape has, or is slowly developing, with this integrated approach where non-typographic specialists would be invited to start editing their type. And that kind of populist user culture, I think, is very positive. And that contrasts with the fontographer approach, where you have a specialized program with each letter drawn visually, interactively, and each letter spaced visually, interactively, in a very specialized application. And that specialist user culture, where we, you know, people have a very kind of medieval guild kind of approach to things, where they think that this is, you know, absolutely for professionals, and that people who are just interested in making the graphics, their graphic design look the way that they wanted to, you know, shouldn't be able to touch that type. It's very different. And that approach emphasizes engineering font software rather than designing type. And FontForge is a good piece of free software for doing that. So this toolkit approach, which is maybe more familiar for maybe this audience, where you have a kind of pipeline of smaller tools, is also starting to become possible with free software. FontForge has recently been refactored so that instead of being a large C program, it's now a big C library with a small C program on top. And this is what has enabled the Python bindings for FontForge. And so I'm hoping to have some Python enthusiasts port RoboFab to FontForge. That's kind of underway at the moment. And with that and things like PyGTK, PyQt, then it's going to be easy for people to make their own font tools. And this kind of has a range of uses. Maybe it would emphasize engineering fonts, but I think there's a good potential for type tools as well. And for example, what I mean by a kind of type design tool is really emphasized with the Metaphont approach. There's a small tutorial called the Metaphont tutorial, which goes through and explains how Metaphont works. So you have these simple points inside the stroke and you pass the pen over it. And this is really constructing the letters. And you do that by writing this algebraic source code. And that takes a certain kind of mind. You know, it's a very abstract process. It doesn't have that rich visual interactivity. And because it was written in the late 70s, it's not actually very useful for anything outside of tech. It's a very convoluted process to get fonts that you could use with modern software out of that. The Polish tech user group, some guys there have been working on MetaType 1, which has done some modernization to produce PostScript outlines. But that whole approach really needs a kind of graphical user interface to give it that interactive edge. That's something that I hope to see coming out of the advances with FontForge and the Python bindings. So designing type. Design happens at scales, and I'm sure many of you know about this when you're designing software, that, you know, the very small aspects build up into larger aspects of the whole structure of the thing. So the low aspect, the bottom aspect, is with the letters, where you design the shapes of the letters, so the black shapes, and that's what's very, apparent to anybody if you ask them to design a typeface. That's what they're going to start focusing on, drawing each individual letter's black shape. But there's also this curious idea of the white shapes in the letter, what typographers call the counters. So there's a kind of a white circle inside the O. There's this kind of circular kind of shaping inside here. And managing those shapes is also part of that task for designing type at that level. The next level is the design type which works when making words. So you have to manage the white space between the letters, which is orders of magnitude complex. And then you also have to manage the black across the letters. So certain letters have things in common. And you can see here, that these are, in this particular typeface, these are mirrored. And as things come along here, you can start to see, that you have these rhythmic patterns to letter shapes. So managing those patterns is also a part of the process. And then with paragraphs of text, then you get kind of emergent effects visually. Maybe that's to do with the quirks in the way that people's eyes work. The type is scaled down a lot compared to when you're drawing it, each individual letter up big. And you also have to deal with that kind of the layout features, the hinting, those kinds of display technology aspects. So future areas. I think there are some unique aspects to designing type when it's done in a free culture way. The opportunity for collaborative design, I think, is very interesting. And this idea that developing a font is software engineering is quite uncommon in the typeface design community. It's not really seen as software engineering, it's seen more as doing graphic design artworking. And I think that with the very, very strong culture of software engineering in the free software community, bringing that to typeface design is going to be quite interesting. So you think using things like version control, diffing different versions, that's going to be interesting. So I'm going to do a couple of demos real quick, just to show off some of this stuff. This is latest CVS build of Inkscape, and if you go to the node tool, you can see that there's a regular Bezier mode and spiral splines mode. And if you put down some splines like this, and turn these points to smooth points, you can see that the spline is interpolating through. You can see on this right side here, we have a straight to curve transition in the line, and that this happens very smoothly. And this is very hard to do with regular Bezier points. Then this is FontForge. This is the kind of character palette view where you pick the character that you'd like to edit, and you open this up. And you have that kind of single letter view of the character. And then you have the metrics view where you would change the spacing for each letter. Like that. And as you can see, the FontForge user interface is not very modern. When George Williams started writing it 10 years ago, he wanted Unicode support. Free toolkits didn't have Unicode support. He wrote his own toolkit. That's quite impressive to me, but it means that it's kind of fallen behind the times. There is some kind of early work on modernizing that though. So, got 5 minutes. Any questions?
Yeah.
All right.
Are there any problems with licensing fonts? I mean, how do you license a free font? Is the GPL good enough, or is a Creative Commons
okay.
license better?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I'm not a lawyer. So I'll go into this kind of briefly. With this, we have this term bandied around intellectual property. Maybe that isn't a good term to use because it confuses various different laws which have basically nothing in common in their details other than that they are government-granted monopolies. And it also implies that you can treat these things as property. So I'd not suggest using that term. And the different laws which it mixes up are mainly trademarks, patents, and copyright. And so trademarks definitely apply to type designs. And in the proprietary font community, then all of these issues have really been bashed out in the courts quite a lot. And so I think that you can use the first two or three letters of someone else's type design in your type design if it looks very similar, and that's okay. But if you use four letters or more, then that's trademark infringement. This is American case law. So if you wanted to make something look very similar to Helvetica, you could call it Hell something, but not Hell something. So that's trademark. In terms of patents, then in the USA, there is no copyright for typeface designs. But there are design patents which you can register, which last for 14 years. And in Europe, we have something similar called a European design right, which works like copyright initially for 4 years, where it's automatic, and then you can apply and register it, which extends it to 5 years, and then you can keep re-registering it up to 25 years. And that came in, I think, 2003. And these things work like patents. So if somebody has a patented design, and you come up completely completely honestly, never seen that design before, then they can sue you. And then copyright itself doesn't apply to typeface designs outside of the UK and Germany, from what I can tell. There's a 25-year copyright term for type designs in the UK. I'm not sure what the length is for Germany. So copyright does apply to the font implementations of typefaces. So in terms of freeing up typographic culture, then it's fairly safe, I would say. I'm not a lawyer, so it's fairly safe. If you see a typeface that's more than 25 years old, it's in the public domain worldwide. And you can make a new implementation of that in software, as long as you don't call it the same name and infringe someone's trademark. I'm not really convinced that that's the best way to free up typographic culture, though, because there is this kind of black art of how to design new type, and that's really what I'm trying to figure out. So that's the kind of general overview. For licensing font software, then the GPL has a problem where if you have a PDF file and you put a GPL font into the PDF, PDF is a kind of program, and so the GPL would then have to apply to the whole PDF. And because there's this difference between programs and data, that might not be appropriate for the rest of the PDF. So the Free Software Foundation in the GPL FAQ has a suggested additional permission to allow you to put a GPL font into some kind of document and allow people to not stick to the GPL. A type designer who works for an organization which does a lot of free software type and font development work developed a free font called Gentium, and he developed his own license to give this font called the Open Font License, which is a general purpose license which meets some of the kind of feelings of type designers who don't want other people selling their stuff as is, or that they don't mind people using their font in something that they sell, if that makes sense. So you couldn't just put an OFL font up on your website and start charging for downloads, but you could sell an embedded computer with the font inside it. And that is a very weak copyleft, so it doesn't have the kind of problems with embedding and so on. So it depends on how you feel about the copyleft issue, whether I recommend to you the GPL with the font exception or the open font license. Both are free software licenses.
I would suggest that non-description, the open font license is...
Sorry?
I would suggest that it's not a free license.
Okay, I've tried to go quickly through that. It's been validated by Debian, Fedora, Free Software Foundation. It's
okay,
definitely...
Your summary wasn't the point.
Yeah, it's... So the particular clause is that you can't sell font software on its own, but you can sell it when it's distributed with a program. And since you can distribute it with a Hello World program to satisfy the license, then it's free software. Because I mean, it's such a ridiculous requirement.
Yeah.
And you know,
presumably you can sell it to the program that's implemented by you, and it says, "Put this on your computer."
Well, I mean, it's the point.
Yeah, the problem is the code and data are the same thing fundamentally.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That's a very social distinction.
So all your programs, all your code is my data.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, and I, from kind of my research into this, then I think that Lisp is a very interesting language because it really pushes that boundary between programs and data, and as far as it can go, pretty much. I mean, I'm not really a programmer, but that's my understanding. So there is this issue, but the point of the license is really, it's a social signaling thing, where they're saying that we don't want people kind of profiteering from this, but we want people to make good use of it. And that's this kind of strange juncture between the free software community and the typeface design community, which has some of the most proprietary-minded people I've ever met. A current issue, actually, is to do with CSS3 web font linking. CSS, the web standards specification, has a method for specifying the URL of a font so that a web browser can download it to render the page using that downloaded font. And basically nobody's ever really implemented this, apart from back in the mid-90s, Netscape and Internet Explorer, who implemented it with DRM font formats. And because CSS3 is kind of restating this feature to encourage people to implement it, there is a movement in the proprietary font community to get Microsoft's DRM font format approved as a W3C standard. But so I don't think that they're going to be very successful with that. We'll see what happens there. But that's what I mean, like the typographic font development, proprietary font development community is very proprietary minded. Because it takes a long time to develop a high quality professional font, especially if it's an original typeface design as well. And it's hard for people to figure out business models to justify that. And I mean, I've been going into the history of this. I think I know how to make money with free software fonts. But let's see what happens.
Well, there's something that's always puzzled me, like, why are there so many font factories? Like, why does the world need more fonts?
Why does the world need more software? More music? I mean, there's always a need for... People have different needs, there's always a need for new stuff.
Right.
Things change. I mean, the context is always changing. Just in terms of the visual aspect of it, then companies want to differentiate themselves, to look different to everyone else. A big part of the industry is doing custom type design for branding. So, similar to the software industry, you know, most software that's written, no one else can buy, it's done privately. And most fonts which are developed, no one else can buy either. Because of that need to differentiate people, you know, it's a poor business advantage.
Looking at your demo.
Yes.
It looked as though you might be better off starting off with InfoSec to make some letters in the first place, but then possibly moving on to font more later to adjust the finding.
Precisely.
Is that?
Yeah, precisely. Again, there's this big distinction between designing the type and producing font software. And these are different tasks, really. So I'm hoping that with Inkscape, there will be this focus on designing type rather than engineering fonts. And that the Inkscape team is very, very vigorous, it's really progressing fast. and I'm working with the Google Summer of Code. So the Google Summer of Code student on the user interface for Inkscape font stuff. So yeah, I hope to see some real progress with that. It's exciting.
Is there anything at all to using the metal font brush stroke or parametric approach as opposed to drawing outlines? Now, apart from metal font, sorry, you did say metal type.
So metal type one has been some work with that. There is a proprietary program for macOS 10 called Calculator, which really shows off what's possible with that kind of approach. I think that it's going to be very possible to re-implement something similar to that in the near future. It's not quite, the infrastructure isn't quite built up yet.
What engine is that using? Is it running?
It's a macOS 10 Cocoa program.
No.
It's completely original software, and it's using the RoboFab macOS 10 Python infrastructure for kind of the font engineering side of things. And you can go to their website and check it out. It's spelled strangely. Spelled like that.
In metal font,
yes.
I've not done really anything with metal font, but I understand that you can specify all in one go a sort of family of shapes at different sizes and sometimes maybe different weights. Is that, and what you were just showing me there with FontForge, for example, it seemed very much a kind of hands-on thing. So how do you, does that allow you to specify the sort of way it changes as the size?
No. So this kind of Icarus or famously Fontographer approach of having pure outlines, pure interactive, with no scripting at all, and that was how most types were developed, means that there is a real restriction on doing things programmatically. So if you wanted to say, that all of these kind of width points, we could start to make this type a little bit wider. Then that's quite difficult, and you can see if I do that with these bezier points, that the curve starts to get a little bit bumpy. It's not looking too good, and the spiral curves, because they're interpolating, that's not really an issue. I'm aware that I'm starting to run well over. Thank you.
So that means that there are still some kind of residual technical advantages of the metal approach.
Yeah.
The kind of the nirvana of having like something with the variables of meta switching, meta font, but the interactivity of something like these tools, we haven't yet got.
Yeah, that's right. And the calculator was developed by a student. I'm studying at the program in Reading, and there's also another postgraduate type design program in The Hague, and a student from that course developed the calculator program. And it's quite basic. I think there's a lot of opportunity for metafont with a GUI. When doing web development, then you have that kind of canvas code view of things. I think an approach like that, or even in Inkscape, where you have the drawing and then you have the XML editor view, and you see the XML tree of the document, and you can go in here and
Does Inkscape export to Metafont? Sorry. Can Inkscape export to Metafont? So you can play with your basic shapes in Inkscape.
Okay.
Then export to Metafont, then maybe put in some variables to get different levels of weights and so on.
Yeah, I mean it's possible that by labeling the nodes, you could do something like that. I mean, basically the way that MetaFont works is it's algebraic. So this kind of talking here about the different widths. So here's this kind of back to front head shape. If we select these points, and you can see so with spiro splines here, if I start moving these points, you can see that the curve stays smooth. This whole curve stays very smooth, whereas with the Bezier one earlier...
Is that still font forward?
This is still font forward using spiro splines instead of Beziers. So, if I do the same thing with the Beziers, then you can see the curve gets bumpy. So that's the difference between spiros and Beziers.
And the other thing is, even if you've got spiro here, once you've done your H, you go over manually and do every single. Is there some kind of linkage between the different letters here? So you say, I want all my vertical stems to be 20% wider.
No, it's not really possible to do that.
That's the other thing, isn't it? With the MetaFont approach.
Right. So the way that MetaFont approach is to say you have the kind of internal structure of the letter. So we have a point here, a point here, a point here, and here, and here, and here. And then you have a pen which passes over that to draw it. Inkscape actually has a pen. Tool here, and there are some presets, so you can say that you want a brush, and you can see that it's done there. My preferences got messed up. What's going on? So you can see that's the kind of, that's the stroke for an N. I'm doing that badly with my ThinkPad pointer. And you can see the way that Inkscape's working there, where it's... It's making sections.
It's drawing a bar perpendicular to the direction of motion of the nodes.
Yes, right. And so each of those sections, it could be a node point in the centre with accurate information about the pressure. As you can see here, we've got these attributes for each section that it's drawing. But the way that it works at the moment is it instantly creates the outline and you lose the structure. So the way that MetaFont works is that you program these points with algebra and you give them algebraic relations. So you say that, say with a cat E, like this, then you'd say that you've got basically 6 points, and you'd say that these points are have the same x value, and these points have the same x value, and these have the same y value, and then the distance between these points can be the golden ratio. And you can specify it with algebra, you can specify it mathematically, and that's indeed what Knuth did with computer modeling. and it has all of these funny little math jokes in there, which you never notice. That means that if you want to say for all of the caps, you've kind of got this midpoint, and if you want to raise that, you just change that one variable and rebuild the whole form. So that's a very powerful approach. The problem is it's not a visual approach, and so it's weird to program something visual and then render it and look at it and then go back to the code. And I think that's where GUI would help. And that I certainly think that it's possible to start drawing these nodes and then to start going to the code view and clearing them up. I can certainly can imagine something like that. So there is a lot of potential for interesting stuff. There just isn't that much interest in developing font software, because in a proprietary world there's not much money for it. There's not that return on investment that they look for. And so consequently there hasn't been any innovation in type design software. These guys in Holland doing the RoboFab stuff, I think that's amazing. They've done some really good work there. RoboFab is now free software. Although it has depends on proprietary font lab, slowly getting people to sort that out, and that's good. It's a real problem though, the way that the proprietary businessmen look at things. I was at a conference where a guy from Adobe who was talking about people Cyrillic, where the Russian Empire colonized various people to the south of Russia, and they said, "You're using Cyrillic now." And they said, "Okay, but we need some different letters to what you guys have, because we speak different languages." And so full Cyrillic has a bunch of, it's kind of like in Latin and Europe, we have a bunch of strange characters like Poland and the Czech Republic, which are just used in those very specific cultures. And so Adobe says, well, it's quite expensive to build up all of these strange extra characters, and we don't really have any customers there. So we'll develop like the kind of 80-90% that most people using Cyrillic will need, and we'll just forget about those other users, because we can't justify the return on investment. And I think that's a serious social problem in the world. There are big problems out there, but this is one of them. With proprietary software, people's culture is getting kind of colonized. Heavy stuff.
Reminds me of the Kurdish Ubuntu distribution, which was very, you can see how localizing Ubuntu to Kurdish can be very politically sensitive in some places.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was mainly people from Turkey who were doing that, if you think about it.
Right.
Okay.
Thanks, Dave, for
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.